Hey, I'm Wes, Substance 3D Evangelist, and today I'd like to showcase the Substance 3D add-on for Blender 4. Substance 3D materials are high quality and versatile, allowing you to customize them for any scene directly in Blender using simple parameters. So now, let's jump into Blender and take a look. So the first thing you're going to need to do is download the Substance 3D add-on for Blender. You can do that by navigating to the Substance in Blender webpage. The link to the webpage you can find in the description of this video, and then you will download the add-on for Blender. You'll also need to download the Substance Integration Tool, and we have that available for Windows, Mac, and Linux. So choose which platform you'll be working on, and let's jump back to Blender and get the add-on installed. To install the add-on, you do that just as you would any add-on in Blender. So for example, I'll click the Install button. I'm going to navigate to where I've downloaded the add-on, and I'm going to select the Substance 3D for Blender, and you can see I have the zip file selected, and then I would click Install Add-on. So I already have this installed, so now let me just come over here to my Blender add-on preferences, and I'm just going to do a search here for Substance, and you can see that the add-on is now enabled. Now here in the preferences, you will see an option to install the integration tool. Again, you will just click the browse button and then choose the other zip file that you downloaded, which is the integration tool. Since I've already done that, you can see here that I have an option to uninstall as well as update the tool. So now we have a lot of preferences here for the add-on, and there are a few things that are pretty important that I want to point out. So for example, if we take a look here, you can see that, there's some defaults. Like for example, the tiling of the material is going to be set to 2 by default, and you can change that to whatever you want, as well as the default resolution that's being computed, and you can go up to 4K. So for example, every time I import a substance material, with this setting at 1024, it's going to generate the textures at 1024. You have your normal format, as well as the export image format that you want to choose. Here, I'm just going to leave it at default. Now, the Substance Remote Engine, this is where you can choose between the CPU or GPU engine, and there's a few options, especially depending on the platform that you're on. So for example, in this case, I'm running on a Mac, so the GPU render is going to be based on the Metal API. On Windows, you can select your GPU, such as if you're using an NVIDIA RTX GPU. Now, here is another option for CPU, and the Substance engine comes in two variants, basically the CPU and the GPU engine. Typically, you're going to want to leave it default at the GPU variant, and that's what I have set here for this Mac version. Now, another very important option that you want to check, and you can see I have it here, which is Cycles Auto Update Textures. So if you're using the Cycles Renderer, which with Blender you most likely are, you're going to want to make sure that you have this enabled so that as you change the parameters and the Substance engine recomputes the textures, those textures will automatically be updated inside the Cycles Render engine. So make sure you have that checked. Now, another important preference is your path and your relative path settings. So for example, the SPS library. Now, default here, it's setting to my desktop, but you could choose this to be anywhere you want. This is going to be where you download all of your Substance materials, maybe from 3D Assets, or if you're using Substance Designer and you're authoring your own Substance materials, maybe that's the library that you keep everything. So you can choose that library path that is automatically going to open as you start to import in new materials. Now, the key here is the relative path. So by default, the Substance material path, it's going to be an absolute path. And that's fine if you're just working on your own computer, but if you ever want to move your project to a different computer, or more importantly, share your project with another user, you want to make sure that for your relative path, you select this checkbox here, which is going to copy the SPS AR file to this SPS AR folder that it will create automatically, which is going to be right next to your Blender file. Now you'll be able to work with relative path to your Blender file. And this is great, again, if you need to switch computers or if you're sharing your project across teams. So there's a couple other settings in here we can take a look at. So for example, this here is your shader preset. This is really just what default projection mode do you want to use? Do you want to use standard or projection box, which is going to be like a triplanar? That's a good one to use. Also, you have here your output. So if we take a look here, you can configure each individual output. So for example, our defaults are going to be base color, metallic, roughness, and normal, and you can see that the color space is set to non-color for these data type maps, and then you can also choose what type of image format as well as bit depth that you want to work. And you do have a lot of control over how these outputs are going to work. And then lastly, here at the bottom, you have just different shortcuts that you can enable for working with the Substance plugin here inside of Blender. Now we can get to finally working with some materials. So in any of your views, if you hit the N key on the keyboard, this will open up your panels and the Substance 3D panel will be available on any view. So again, I can mouse over any view and hit the N key to view the Substance 3D panel. So here with the Substance 3D panel at the very top, you have some buttons where you can load substance materials. We'll do that in just a moment. And once you load a material, here you will have a list of all the materials that are loaded and available for you to use in your scene. Here you can apply materials as well as browse the Substance Community Asset site. So if I click this button, it will open up a web browser. The Substance Community Asset is a free community sharing site. It's a great place to get substance materials. If you have the Substance Collection, you can access the 3D Assets, which is a huge repository of substance materials. You can duplicate substance materials as well as reload and delete them. Now, there is a substance preference for applying the material as you load it to the selected object. I have that disabled in the preferences. So now I will click load and I am going to browse for where I have some substance materials downloaded. Here I have this terracotta glossy SBS AR and I can simply load this substance material. Now here you can see that in my substance material list, the terracotta glossy material is now available for me to use in my scene. With my object selected, I can just click apply and this will apply the material. So now that we have a material applied to the asset, here in our shader graph, we can see that we have the mapping nodes are plugged into the substance material group in the UV coordinates. And then here we have our channels connected to the principled BSDF material. So for example, we have base color to base color, metal to metal, roughness to roughness, and so on. Here inside the actual group itself, you can see the textures that are generated by the Substance engine. So now let's take a look at the Substance graph parameters. So to start, we have presets. You can choose presets if the Substance material has any embedded presets. You can also create your own presets, or you can import presets from other Substance applications. You also have settings for tiling. This is a preference that I had set in the preferences for the add-on, so I set that default to be 2. And we also have our resolution. So here you can change the resolution of the substance texture to different resolutions depending on the project that you're going to be working on. So here you can see that I'm recomputing these substance textures to be 2K. In this case, I'm going to leave it to 1024 so that I can work through the graph parameters pretty quickly here in just a moment. Now, if we drop down here to outputs, here's where I can see the outputs that are connected to the shader by default, which in my case here is going to be base color, normal, roughness, and metallic. I have the format, the image format that's being created, as well as the bit depth. Now, here under this drop down, I can choose the projection for the substance texture. Again, as I set in the Substance 3D add-on preferences, box projection is what I'm using by default, which is like triplanar projection, but we can choose other things like physical size. Now, for physical size to work, you would have had to have modeled your asset to real world scale. Then the projection will match the physical size embedded within the material to match the real world physical scale of the object. So in my case here, I'm just going to leave this at box projection. Now, if I want to enable additional outputs, if I just click this button, you can see that these are the other outputs that are available to me that are within this substance material. So here is a case where I may want to work with some displacement. So here I will enable my height. And by doing that, you'll see here that in my shader, a new node was created for me. So here I have now a displacement node. If we take a look at the group here for the substance material, I now have a height texture that was generated. An output is being plugged into this displacement node, and then now that is being plugged in here to the material output here for the shader itself. We'll talk about displacement a little bit later on. Now we can finally get here to the actual parameters for the substance material. So here I have some general parameters, and in this particular material, I have some roughness settings. So for example, if I just change this parameter, let's set it down pretty low, you can see the result here provides a very glossy, shiny result for this terracotta glossy material. I could also go the other way and just increase this slider, and we'll set this to be a bit more rough. So maybe I want to split the difference and go with something around 0.32, and this is the overall roughness that I want to generate. And you can see that in real time, the Substance engine is regenerating the textures at the resolution I have set for the graph, and everything's still being plugged back into the material for me. I also can change some other parameters. Here, let's take a look. There is this vertical line. If I were to maybe increase this a bit more, you can see that this is going to create some additional vertical lines here. Here, let's decrease it so we can really see what we're doing. We'll just set it right here. Let's just set it all the way to 0. And here you can see those lines are gone. Now we'll set it, you know, all the way to 1. And now we'll see the lines come back. Now I'm noticing that maybe I want to change the rotation of this. And here's where I can jump over to my shader. And in the rotation, I'm going to set the Z value to 90. And you can see that just simply rotates my textures. Now again, depending on the substance material, you could have more general properties. However, there is a group with every substance material that you get from Substance 3D Assets called technical parameters. And these allow you to do some image kind of adjustment settings. So for example, if I wanted to maybe increase the normal intensity, I can do so by just simply changing this slider, and that's going to increase the normal intensity. Now I'm seeing a bit more bump here in the detail. Or if I wanted to maybe increase contrast here, I can do so. So we'll just slightly increase the contrast. We get something like that. Oh, it looks a little too saturated now. Let's just knock that down by just changing the saturation value, and you get something like that. So again, these technical parameters can help to do some quick image adjustments. Now, of course, you could also jump over to your shader editor, and you could use any blender nodes in between the substance group and the material itself to further augment the substance textures. So with that, you can see that it's pretty simple. I can come over here, I can load a substance material, I can apply it, I can set resolution settings, and then I can jump over here to my general parameters for that substance and then make some tweaks and changes to the parameters to make a variation of that material. Something else that's kind of fun is maybe if I'm duplicating this material. So for example, I could come over here and click this duplicate button and maybe assign this to a different material. But there is this option here, or this button, which is kind of like roll the dice is what it is. And if we do that, what it's going to do is just randomize all the settings. And it's just a really nice and quick way for me to, if I'm using this material across different assets, I can just, you know, set up my parameters and then just click this quick randomize button. You can see what it does is just changes the random seed value here. So the last thing I want to cover is how displacement is going to work. So for my outputs, I already have a height output enabled, and it gives me this displacement node. So here's what we're going to do. We are going to jump over here to our object. And the first thing is I'm going to add a modifier, and let's add a subdivision surface here. And so we'll come back to this in just a moment. And now we're going to switch to the Cycles rendering engine. And you can see here that I have my feature set is set to experimental. And for the device here, I could set this to my GPU compute as well. And for the actual subdivision, I have some subdivision settings here. So now with the object selected, I want to revisit that subdivision modifier. And you'll notice here that adaptive subdivision is enabled because I have those experimental features enabled for the Cycles renderer. So now I can set some values here, and I can see that my final scale render is set to 1 pixel, and my viewport is set to 1 pixel as well. We'll see how that does. For my scale here on the displacement, this is where I can start to change values here. So let's try something like 0.25. And we can see here that that is starting to displace the surface. It's a little bit too much. So I think what I'll do is just go back to this 1.35. Let's see what that does. Okay, I think that's going to work for what I want. And now as I start to refine this, I could jump back here to my Cycles renderer. And this is where I need to jump down to my subdivision and maybe set the dicing rate depending on the quality versus the trade-off of rendering speed I'm looking for. One other thing that I could look at here with this material, so again, the object selected, and if I jump over here to my material settings, you want to make sure that displacement is set to displacement and bump or just displacement. Now, the substance material, as soon as I enable height and it creates the displacement node for me, it is going to take care of this setting for me automatically. However, you can see the difference if I set this just to displacement. Here you're getting just that displacement information. And maybe in this case, this is what I want because I have the displacement, it's driving the detail, and I don't want to over intensify that by trying to add bump on top of it. And that's going to close out this tutorial on working with the Substance 3D add-on in Blender. Substance materials provide a very powerful and rich workflow for texturing your assets inside of Blender. Thanks a lot for watching, and I'll see you next time.